So hi, good evening everybody, and thank you so much for taking out the time on a day like this, on a Saturday evening. And for some of you, it's still morning, Bhandari sir, thank you so much for joining us today. As we all know that the theme for today's webinar, second webinar, is around environment and sustainability. And I just want to take a minute to make a few introductory remarks before we go to our panelists. A lot of people ask that, you know, why is it that we needed to discuss environment as a particular theme? And we felt that those of us who are curating this webinar, we felt that, you know, while economy and healthcare are kind of some of the obvious themes that are being discussed around the COVID issue, environment per se has not really taken up that kind of focus from people around the world. And of course, we know that while there is so much negativity out there about the impact of COVID-19, as we discussed in the first webinar on people, professions, and livelihood, perhaps one of the positive things coming out of the COVID-19 is the incidental positive impact that we see on the environment, not just in India, but world over. Now, how do we pause, reflect, and figure out a way of capturing that momentum that has incidentally fallen upon our hands? That broadly is a theme with which we are entering today's discussion and debate. I must say that when we say the word environment, at least for the purposes of today's conversation, we want to give it the broadest ambit possible. So while we are talking about, of course, the physical and the natural environment, we're also thinking about renewable energy. We have, with us, Mr. Gautam Bhandari, his company, his investment funds, they do invest a lot in clean energy. So we would want to bring in some of those aspects. We have with us Mr. Murthy, who can also talk specifically about, you know, urban designing and urban planning. So we are trying to interpret the word environment in its broadest way. So, without further ado, let's come to our first panelist for today, Mr. Krishna Kumar. Now, sir, you don't need any introduction. You know, every person who calls himself or classifies himself as an environmentalist in the country has heard of your name, and you have a long, long work which I possibly cannot summarize in a minute or two. But I would like to start today's webinar, you know, sir, with an observation, which forgive me, you know, if you disagree with it. But in my observation, sir, as human beings, we often do not value what we already naturally have. You know, on a lighter note, I feel that, you know, if let's say a man is very handsome, the likelihood of him going for somebody who has more brains is more higher, and vice versa. So as human beings, there's a tendency that we somehow don't appreciate as much what we already have. We take it for granted, and we're always attracted to the other, you know. So what are your broad thoughts on when we think about the environment, specifically in the wake of COVID-19, where has humanity come? And are we still seriously concerned about the impact that we are having on the environment, and even what our relationship is with the environment? So what are your thoughts about how we should go about framing this entire debate, if I may say so?
All right. Thank you, Avni. And to begin with, it's lovely to chat with all the aliens and the dalians, whoever would be joining in. We are looking at 50 years of Thatcher gone. Now, talking about environment, let's get to the subject immediately, because I'm sure you'll be cracking the whip very fast on that. But environment, as I see it, is something which could be termed a little different to, I would say, nature. Nature is an all-encompassing thing, where an environment is something that we have created. The human beings have created an environment for themselves. Now, that's the environment we usually keep talking about all the time. But now, before we go into the discussion of this environment and nature and our place in it, the human being's place in it, I'll request you to show that clip. But before that, just a minute, for half a minute, I'll just talk about that clip. This is a clip that we are talking about. Is usually what happens that our brains, our mind cannot comprehend huge numbers, huge, let's say, if I say the planet was came into existence in, to existence in 4.3 billion years ago. Now, that doesn't make sense, because after about 1,000 years, it can be a couple of billion years. It doesn't make difference. So to show that 4.3 billion years, let's take right from the beginning till today of the conception of this planet, put it in 24 hours, and then see where did human being come in? What was their contribution to this planet? And where is this planet being taken by the human being? Because they are the driving force today on this planet. So now if you could show that video, right, please. Yes.
So very quickly, Mr. Krishna Kumar has requested that we play a video clip for everybody. I'm going to share my screen in just about a second, such that all of you will be able to see this video screen and see this video clip.
Ever thought, what if Earth only existed for 24 hours? In the first 10 minutes itself, the Earth collides with planet Theia, resulting in the creation of Moon, without which our days would have been only 6 hours long. Life originated at 4 a.m. with unicellular organisms, the true ancestors. Teaspoon full of soil contains more organisms than all humans. The single-celled organisms have moved to multicellular organisms, and life begins to prosper on Earth as we see the first instances of sexual reproduction. Seaweed has started growing, and oxygen is now spread across the Earth's atmosphere. Marine animals, who take up 99% of the planet's population, only came into existence in the last 3 hours. It is only now that we see land plants growing. Yes, the marine life came even before the plants on Earth. Think about this the next time you order yourself a seafood platter. It is not until 10:56 p.m. that dinosaurs appear. Wait, we're still at just dinosaurs? But as our history books tell us, the dinosaurs went extinct, but the mammals survived. It is already 11:39 p.m. and no humans? The day is almost over. You must be wondering, when do we arrive? It took almost 4.6 billion years of evolution for us to exist, and we have changed so much in so little time. The Homo sapiens of today have only had a culture for less than 50,000 years. You think there's still time?
Right. So this depicts what we have done with the planet. We only existed for 1 second. In these 24 hours, and we have created a completely different planet. Now, this is the kind of damage we've done. But as in the last session, I picked up one phrase from Gajendra, I think it was, who said that the humans are programmed to survive. Yes, absolutely true. The humans are programmed to survive, and they will survive. But I would also add that along with the humans, every little creature on this planet is programmed to survive. Now, what is the difference between the human survival and every other creature surviving on this Earth? Now, let's look at it that in a way that when all the other creatures on this planet, when the nature changes for them, they mutate, they evolve, they adapt. But that is only guided by the nature. As the nature changes, as slowly as it may change, they adapt and evolve. Whereas when the human being came along for the last second of this planet, on this 24 hours, they decided to take hold of the nature. They said, we will do the changing. We will change the environment to suit us. It is not the environment or it's not the nature which is going to command us. And we went about in a manner that today is very, very, very clear for us to see what has happened. Now, having said that, we have brought ourselves to almost to the brink of disaster. But we again come back to the same phrase that we are programmed to survive. And so if we were only programmed to survive, it was fine. But because we took up the nature as such and changed it to our convenience, and not only to convenience, to the kind of luxury that we want, that we live in today, that is where the problem arose. The biggest paradox today, and so why human beings are different, is that only mammal or only animal or mammal which has a logical and intelligent mind. Now, with that logic and intelligence, we have changed everything on this planet. So the biggest paradox that we face today is that by the virtue of that same knowledge and logic by which we have created this world to suit our convenience, it is that same logic and intelligence which is taking us to that destructive point. And this is what the paradox of this whole planet is. That is that very, the very fact or the very nature that has made us so powerful on the planet is the virtue by that very nature that we'll be destroyed. So that means that this, somewhere along the line, can we change that programming that has happened, that the kind of programming to survive we have within us, the human being, can that same intelligence and logic apply to changing that program so that we live differently? Do we have it in them? So for this session now, I'm going to leave you with two questions. The first question is, has human being aware that they are at the verge of destruction? Are we aware? Because we have seen so many calamities happen and we've gone back to business as usual. We have not bothered to stop and think. So the first question is, have we really realized that we are bringing it to the brink of destruction, this planet? If it is, let's put it like a parliamentary question. If the answer to the first question is yes, then the next question is, does the human logic with all its technical, its scientific, all the knowledge, intelligence, is it capable of changing ourselves so that we change our program to survive in a different manner? So I'll leave you to that. I'll leave you all with this. These two questions, and maybe we can take this discussion forward.
Right. And those, I think, you know, sir, sum up a lot of dilemma that we as humanity face. But I want to move quickly to our second speaker for today's panel, Mr. Gautam Bhandari. So my question to you is that, you know, what Mr. Krishnakumar was saying, it speaks of an anthropocentric approach that human beings have always had towards environment, where human beings are the center of all our thinking about the environment. Now, some people may say that we need to push for a dialogue where we, you know, move away from this anthropocentric approach. But, you know, you're coming from a background where you understand the economics of environment better than most of us. So, for example, you know, there is a second school of thought which would say that if we want to be serious about environment, we have to be serious about the economics of environment. And when we're thinking about, for example, shifting to the clean energies or the green energy resources, we need to very carefully think about these economics of environment. What kind of economic incentives can we, you know, put in place for a systematic transformation or transition towards a green, sustainable planet? So what are your thoughts, sir? You invested in clean energy and you're seeing how the world is now reacting. Do you think in particular the COVID-19 is going to, you know, be a game changer? Or do you think, you know, things going business as usual as far as clean energy is concerned moving on? I know I've grabbed in a couple of questions in there, but I'll leave it to you to choose, you know, what resonates with you.
Sure. So, look, I'll attempt to answer all of them. And if I forget, please pull me back and you can ask any question I forgot. So, look, I think Mr. Krishna had actually a very good thought, right? I mean, are we, you know, how is it that we will restart our native effort to survive, right, and to thrive, actually? So, for better or worse, humans have organized themselves on economic blocks, right? So, in order to figure out whether we go left or right, you know, there is a trial and error, and we have done this for hundreds of years. And then within that, right, there is the currency in which we trade time is actually money, right? So effectively, how much time you spend multiplied by some fraction of talent basically boils down to an economic system that underpins all of things we do, right? So, and look, the reality is we have consumed, we have a voracious appetite for energy, for instance. You know, we are all sitting in rooms with air conditioning or lights, and so I think over time the human planet is consuming a fair amount of energy, which is basically extractive, right? So the history of energy has largely been extractive. And in that basic system, frankly, the cost of carbon is zero. So it's a shared cost. So if I happen to burn a lot of, wood in my backyard, nobody else pays for it. It's shared, it disappears. And so why do I bring that up, right? So every year in Delhi, the skies turn black or gray in the winters, and people say it's fog. It's not fog, guys. It's basically smoke, right? So it occurs because farmers are burning their crops all around. It occurs because people are driving cars. That's a shared cost, and we tend to sort of gloss over it in a large extent because everybody has a justification. Certainly the car we drive is, of course, very important to us. The crops that the farmer is burning are important to him, and he's poor and you are poor. And so since everybody is poor, nobody wants to pay. So if you want to make this thing work, people have to pay up. That's I think there's no running away from it. No government can subsidize it. Government, frankly, is not a value-creating organization, right? It just allocates capital from one person to another. So effectively, in societies where this has worked, this basically, people have explicitly said there's a price to this pollution, there's a price to the way of your life. You can choose to live it that way, but you have to pay for it. And so over time, human behavior gets corrected. People quickly realize that this is not an optimal way. And they try, being economic animals, try and change behavior, right? And so that has worked. Look at Germany. It used to have coal as their number one sort of fuel. Changed to solar and wind, even though sun doesn't shine much in Germany. But yet they have gone ahead because there is a price for carbon, I think. That is a logical way to change. Now, what happens after crisis, right? So look at Taiwan post the SARS epidemic. So look, India was spared and India never had SARS. Go back in 2002, 2003, the Taiwanese society was a consumption-led society. They, frankly, Foxconn, your Apple phone, everything was made in those contract manufacturing societies. Heavy doses of pollution, basically, the reason people went to Taiwan to do contract manufacturing was the lax environmental laws, and there was no price for that. So along came SARS, people had a near-death experience, the society took a very big hit, thousands and hundreds and thousands of people died, very unfortunately, and I think that society afterwards went back and said, is our balance with the environment a good one, a healthy one, or unhealthy one? And they concluded it was unhealthy. They had been polluting their own rivers and soils. It's a small island, so there's frankly no place to run. And so that hit them in the backyard. So combination of a stress, a tragedy, a small confined place made them recognize that they need to do something. If you now go to Taiwan today, you will not recognize it from 2003. It's clean. They have cured most of their dump sites. They heavily believe in renewable energy, from solar to wind. Companies pay their fair share and citizens pay their fair share. Right? You often point it to the other guy that the company should pay, the government should pay. They don't have any money to pay. You have to pay, right? So we as human beings have to pay. You may ask, what is the cost of all this in order to correct it for the economics of clean energy to work. Cost is not much. You know, for most, we calculated it, we haven't done it in India, but we have calculated it in Ireland and other countries. It's the cost of two Starbucks. Okay, so even within India, people say we are a poor country. Not really. There's a lot of waste. There's 20% of the power that you produce in India is simply waste. Right. So over half the grains that are taken from farmers are simply rotting. So it's not a poor country. It's just an inefficient country. So I think we have to look within our systems and see where is that efficiency? How can we actually capture it so that we as a society progress? Right. And I think this is hard decisions. Nobody else will do it. You basically have to say, this is the cost of my life. This is the cost, as Mr. Krishna Kumar said, of living in this environment. And I'm going to bear my fair share. So I'm not asking you to bear, you know, your undue share, just your fair share. So it's only good manners that if you, you know, have a dirty plate, you clean it. And so it's only good manners that if you live in an environment and you spoil it, that you know, you spend the effort, the time, and the money to clean it.
Yeah.
So I think that piece needs to get captured.
So one quick question that's coming from Mr. Pathak in the Q&A section. He's saying that in the clean renewable energies is sometimes, you know, being seen as conflicting from biodiversity because the sites that are chosen, you know, don't necessarily give a thought to biodiversity. And sometimes you may see the two environmental values may actually conflict with each other. That is clean renewable energy on the one hand, but then biodiversity on the other. So do you think that that's a cause for concern? Do you think any systematic thinking happening around it? And what does one do when those kind of two environmental values or norms, you know, conflict with each other from the perspective of policymakers, let's say?
Look, here's the thing, right? So we are probably one of the largest investors in clean energy globally. You know, we own 9 gigawatts of power. We have built much of it, solar, wind, hydro, right? And this is a question that often comes up. And I think the reality is life is full of choices. There is no clear black and white. If somebody told you there is a project that everything is perfect, it doesn't exist. So for all projects, something is going to get displaced. We just have to accept it. You have to make the best choice you can and you have to accept it. So if you put a solar farm and if it was on you know, bushy area or slightly forested area, the trees, the shrubbery is going to get displaced. But then people adapt, right? I think Mr. Krishna Kumar was correct in that too. The society, the environment, the animals, everything adapts around it. If you were a purist, you know, all of Delhi would not exist. All of New York would not exist. So how did people dredge and then build roads like within 2 meters of the seawall? Paris would not exist, right? So the reality is we as humans will affect the environment. We cannot be a zero footprint people in life as we know it. There are choices. And rather than debate and waste time on, you know, what is the optimal way, or frankly look to quotes, with all due respect to you, It's a choice. You try and do the best you can. And even if you're wrong, it's not the end of the world. It's okay. It's better than doing nothing,
yeah.
Right? So the worst mistake people do is the debate, and generations of people's lifetime pass and no decision is taken. So you're better off either saying yes or no, both are okay, right? And move on,
yeah.
And try the next project. Right. So I think an instant or a quick decision, frankly, specifically in the case of India, is much more important than, frankly, what we have for the past, you know, eons, which is no decision.
And you know, just before coming to our third speaker, Mr. Singh, I actually want to go to Mr. Murthy for the response that came out from Mr. Bhandari, which is about Mr. Murthy, you know, you're part of, you're keeping a very careful eye over a lot of projects which involve urban planning, which will drastically redo the way urban planning is done and how we are trying to change cities consciously. Now, this entire conundrum that Mr. Bhandari pointed out, you know, which is about, well, you can't have it all, right? There are certain limitations within which policymakers have to operate. So even if you are, let's say, an environmentally conscious policymaker, do you think in your own work, through your own experience and in your own observations, that this kind of element of sustainability is being actually, you know, brought in all our urban planning and designing? Are we actually doing it consciously at all? Or are we even in 2020 going absolutely haphazardly, even in our capital cities like Delhi? And you know exactly the kind of projects I'm talking about. Because they're very debated, we don't necessarily have to point out one project. But I want a larger question, that do you think that even today in 2020, that kind of environmental consciousness has seeped in into our urban planning and urban designing?
First of all, it's a pleasure to be here among all our old aliens. And with so many more in the room, I can see another 104 have joined us. Coming to what a couple of other people have said before as well, and in fact, when Gautam said that thing, you know, I was thinking from his perspective as a person dealing with economy, he's absolutely right. Any decision is better than no decision at all. And yes, in India, we have suffered the fact that most of our governments, our policymakers, tend to go into the sense of into this state of ennui where nothing happens, neither positive nor negative, for ages. Having said that, in India, we have this strange belief. I mean, I think it is a worldwide problem, but somehow we Indians have it stronger than other people. The belief in a silver bullet. You know, we lurch from policy to policy. Planning is a natural part of human life. You know, a housewife plans her budget. Every one of us get up in the morning, we plan our day. Family wedding comes up and we all sit down in a conclave and for months and weeks we plan it. But when it comes to our world, our environment, the cities that we live in, somehow we discard all of that. We go to sleep for months, then we wake up, realize there's a problem, and then suddenly comes a silver bullet. Now, therefore, yes, a decision is good, but it has to be a well thought out, equitable, efficient, logical decision. And we have enough time to think of those in the interregnums that we get. So environmental planning, and then coming down to the microcosm of urban planning, should be an ongoing effort. Successful societies are constantly thinking about, debating, looking at the change happen as human beings progress from stage to stage and new inventions come up, and recalibrating the societies to include those in a positive manner. And that is somewhere where we Indians have singularly failed.
But you know, I mean, there's a question by Santhanam sir, which is directed to Krishna Kumar sir, but it kind of resonates with what you're saying. Do you think that it's largely, I mean, if we kind of zoom out again, do you think it could be a result of, you know, a fragmented consciousness, which then kind of shows up in everything, in the way we think about the environment, in the way we think about policy, that we're never kind of taking a comprehensive approach? There's no plan. I mean, how many planned cities do we have in India, even in 2020, right? We kind of continue with the one or two that we know. So do you think that it's the cause of it could be, as Santhanam sir points out, a larger fragmented consciousness? Or do you think that there are other factors which are more responsible for why, you know, I'm thinking of the why, Mr. Murthy, like, why is that planning so fragmented? Why aren't we thinking about it? Like, if we go deeper and dig up the causes, what do you think are the causes for it?
That's a very interesting question. And I don't know how many people are aware that we are the race that invented cities and urban planning. The oldest planned cities on earth, which are Bhirana in Haryana, Mehrgarh, which is now in Pakistan, belong to the Harappan civilization. Considering that we come from the civilization that invented planning as a process and left behind physical remnants, if you look at our cities today, they're probably the worst planned. And it's not very easy, it's not very difficult to see why this happens. One part of it, which you're saying a fragmented consciousness, that is a kind way of looking at it. We are a country with the majority of people who are poor, who just strive to get through each day, and therefore there isn't much thought to be given to aspects as abstract as what we should be doing day after tomorrow. That could be particularly a reason why. And okay, yes, governments have grappled with poverty and the lack of resources, and maybe they've got distracted and taken their eye off how the planning is going. But much larger than all of that is a sheer venality that unfortunately our policymakers, our politicians in the 70 years have had in how they look at certain things. You know, there's an absolute lack of recognition of certain things which are just very human imperatives. We don't recognize need. Our cities don't look at who are the people there, what do they actually need. Today, when the cities are being emptied of the laborers, suddenly we're getting conscious of the fact that there were lakhs and lakhs of people who inhabited the same city as us, had no spaces for them, there were no resources formally allocated to them, they lived in the interstices of our society, and it's only now in this crisis that suddenly we're all noticing and now beginning to worry about how are we going to manage after this when they don't come back. I mean, every day brings out an article talking about how there's going to be a labor problem and they're not coming back. So all the while they were there, we didn't think about them, and now suddenly we think about them. So we don't recognize need, and therefore our plans don't look after the amount of commerce needed. So rampant commercialization illegally happens in our cities. We don't look at the housing needs of a large majority. So shanty towns and slums come up. Need is never going to run away. I mean, need is never going to go away. So therefore, human beings start doing informal things to look after their needs. And there goes the whole planned city or the planned state, which is one. The second thing that we don't recognize is poverty. You know, there is no silver wand which we can wave and poverty is going to go away. Unfortunately, our politicians have neglected it. One could even say they've nurtured it, because a poor populace is a very easy populace to buy votes from. And therefore, we cannot think in terms of all of us living in nice little flats. That reality is never going to come. There are people who are so poor that even if I were to give them a flat, they're going to sell that flat and go away and set up another shanty town somewhere else, because that's their monetary reality. So therefore, I mean, it sounds like a drastic idea for any non-architect or planner. We need to create spaces for slums in our cities. Well-serviced shanty towns, which will never go up in value because a middle-class person will never value them. We need to create spaces for shanty markets, for food carts. Now, we travel to Singapore, we go and see the hawker centers there. We eat at the hawker centers every day because there's so much wonderful food from all over Southeast Asia. We don't come back here and tell our policymakers that, hang on, why in India, when there is so much street food available and it's so delicious in every single city in India, why don't we have similar hawker centers? So a lot of our learnings from when we travel and see other things, we don't come back and demand it in this country. I mean, I think to one extent, we've also given up hope in demanding anything because nothing seems to happen as requested.
And I just want to take that thread to come to Mr. Singh. And sir, forgive me, you know, if I sound more like a devil's advocate, you know, in asking my question to you. But I do think that, you know, the role of media is crucial in the way environment is portrayed in this country and the way environment is perceived in this country. I mean, so, you know, you have very wide experience, you know, serving in your position as editors with different newspapers, leading newspapers of the country. So what is your own experience? Do you think that media just does not care, that environment is not kind of a hot thing that pays money? It somehow does not seem to capture the minds of the people, and media kind of just follows that lead. Why is it that, you know, we don't kind of see that leadership, that kind of coverage, that environment, broadly speaking, but all these different issues that we're discussing today, you know, are not discussed as much as one would like to see in the media?
Yeah, that's true. I'll agree with what you said. And in fact, last time when we spoke on the phone, you said the same thing. Yeah. And I think it's a fair criticism. It's a valid criticism. Let me put it this now. If you ask me, why is it happening? Why doesn't the media mainstream environmental issues? Well, I can't put my finger on one particular thing, but let me just say that two things I will say. Firstly, you know, the whole ecosystem of India, let's say. Now, I mean, even now, after 73 years of independence, we are still an emerging economy. We are still a developing country. We have about 50 to 60% people who are poor. We have huge amount of illiteracy, huge amount of communalism, casteism. Now, when this, given this background, given this these circumstances, now I think how did, you know, these, I think in a way shaped policy making and you know, prioritizing national needs. Now, by that thing, I don't just say policy planners and the governments, but even you know, the academics, common people, even say NGOs, activists. Now, how many academics, you know, are there on, you know, studying environmental issues? I think there are more people in from academia who are, you know, engaged in economy and other related issues, which are, I'm not saying that environmental issues are not priority, but I think it was a question of prioritizing what India should do at that, you know, when we became independent. Now, so we were plagued with a lot of problems, and 73 years later, we still have a lot of these problems. So I think inadvertently, national priorities got shaped that way. So not just by the, as I said, policy planners, but and the governments, but by everybody.
Right.
The same thing happens perhaps to the media also. So that is why perhaps because of that, I'm just saying this is perhaps because this is my own thing. Because of that, this could be one of the reasons why the media also is not such a, you know, a mainstream topic.
Right.
Second thing, probably I would say that there has been, to some extent, commodification of news. Now, news has become like any commodity, like a product, like a Bournvita and a Colgate. Now, the more you sell it, you know, you prioritize news, seeing whether it will have reader interest, whether it will be acceptable to the consumers of news, which is basically readers for newspapers, and as for TV channels, is viewers. Now, so media houses have shaped their news coverage, let's say,
right,
based on, you know, what people want to read, not necessarily what people should be reading. I would say that.
Yeah, I think that's a very valid point. And Tanvi, you know, now as somebody, you're a wildlife photographer, you know, as a young person who is watching this debate, who is kind of obviously passionate about environment, to be in something as niche and as wonderful as wildlife photography, you know, if I may say so, I just want to bring down this kind of entire debate and say that, you know, as an individual, as a young person, or just as anybody who's environmentally conscious, you who's watching this debate and who's saying, you know, what Mr. Singh is saying, that unfortunately the priorities of this country are different. Environment just doesn't figure. You feel a certain sense of helplessness, you know. So, I mean, do you have a story which you think could relate with most people about, you know, how do as individual young people or even passionate people about environment look at this entire helplessness?
So, Avni, the thing is, helpless people, and I'm definitely one of them, we are a very, very big percentage. I think even people who are contributing to you know, betterment of environment are still struggling with the fact that they are not able to do enough for the environment and for the people. So, we are a big percentage. I think the reason why we are not able to do enough is because there are not enough monetarily rewarding avenues for us to channelize our passion. So that makes it very difficult for us to do something, even though we want to, even though we have the passion for it. And sadly, I think we should openly acknowledge the fact that we are dependent, inextricably dependent on a system that is not functioning. It's a system that is constantly prioritizing economy over ecology, and it's affecting everyone, including the billion of other animals that we share the planet with. And that's my answer for that.
But Tanvi, I want to quickly come to you, and with that, you know, sir, begin a quick round of questions for everybody, because so in the first round, you know, we kind of highlighted the issues. But now let's take stock and say, okay, you know, based on our backgrounds, based on our experiences, what are some of the things that you think the governments are already doing? But more importantly, what are some of the best practices that we can draw upon? What do you think are the gaps, the systematic gaps in the policy making, specifically vis-a-vis environment, that you think can be worked upon? So you're in Harare, Tanvi, and the way I understand, and I understand a little, I'm sure you understand much better, the way African countries, especially Zimbabwe, their approach to their wildlife, their approach to the environment is very different from India. So drawing upon the best practices, what would you say are some of the things that, you know, we could consider in here in India, or even suggest as possible takeaways for our policymakers?
I don't think we can truly fairly draw comparisons between the way wildlife is taken care of in Zimbabwe in comparison to India, because it's a tourism industry is what these countries are actually surviving on. Situation in Zimbabwe is it's pretty bad. I mean, it's people don't have water to wash their hands, so the COVID situation can get totally out of control here. It's wildlife is the only thing that they are, I think, properly taking care of, is because that is their only ticket to the world market. Like, tourism is, that's all they are surviving on. That's a big chunk of their forex is coming from tourism. In India, it's a big hub of a lot of industries, not just wildlife, even though we take pride in it, but it's a multitude of industries and occupations and fields. So even though I would like to, on that point, I can't properly and fairly draw comparisons between the two countries. But to your question about what the government can do in India, I think that's one thing. We need to have objective solutions and ideas. Mr. Krishna Kumar had said, we need to stop having frivolous debates that often end up being, who's got the more facts. And we kind of end up discouraging people who want to do something, who are passionate about it, but don't have enough knowledge and don't know where to start. So the ideas and the topics or discussions for ideas, it should not stop. We need to amplify them further and further with our children, with our family, even people we naturally deal with, even rickshawalas and bhais. I mean, even if we just plant a seed of awareness, it's going to go a long way when a time actually comes that a change is supposed to happen properly. And one more thing about I have a couple of ideas and I'd love to share and have even feedback on it. Please, like, is the government or even private sector heavily invest in research and development to explore greener and cheaper technologies? Is that really happening in today's world? I doubt it, but I would love to have your feedback on that.
Okay. I will flag that question for Mr. Bhandari later. I have some thoughts on it. But I want to come quickly to you, Mr. Krishna Kumar. And there are a couple of questions. I mean, of course, the fragmented one was one. Mr. Murthy answered that partially. But at the same time, let's just address the elephant in the room, which is, as I think, you know, Mr. Singh puts this, Mr. Mayur Dwas Singh, that what would it take to streamline sustainability in India? What would be the environment? Of course, there will be environmental costs, there will be social costs, there will be political costs. But what would it take for us to kind of, you know, actually move this debate in some constructive manner? Or would you say we are being just pessimistic, you know, young people who don't know very much, and that we have in fact come a far place from where we began in 1950? How would you take this entire situation? And looking forward, what would be your suggestions and takeaway points for all of us?
A difficult question, but nonetheless, I'm going to answer a couple of questions here. Also, Mr. Kogan Singh's question also will be answered here, or rather not a question, but a statement.
Yeah.
That India started off with, when the independence came, it started off with to build up the nation. It did not pay much attention to environment, but it was building the nation to catch up with the rest of the world. And it obviously sidelined environment as such. But I would say that in 1972, when Indira Gandhi went to Stockholm to address, and she was the only developing country leader to address that that conference of all the leaders of the world. And there she said that, well, we are going to look at the environment, but not at the cost of the poor and the development. And that was the stance in 1972. She came back in 1972, was the Wildlife Protection Act formed. That was her doing. In 1980, Forest Conservation Act was passed. Now, these two are very powerful acts that the government passed in the parliament. And even today, these acts hold the environment together in this country and the protection of the wildlife. Now, to say that what are we doing to balance the wildlife, the environment, the development, and as the business goes forward, all the other aspects of business. And therefore, there I would say that politics, because they are the decider of what policy is going to happen, politics has to be first also looked at. Now, all of you are quite aware how politics works, not only in India, but all around the world. So there are these two kind of politicians, let's say. One politician looks at what people want. They will say those things. They will make those sounds, get their votes, and carry on with their life. That is one kind of politician, and is a clever politician. The other politician is a statesman who will not only come to power, but he will also make suggestions which people may not like. It will be suggestions for the nation. It will be suggestions for building up a nation. It will be suggestions for protecting the environment. People may not like it, but that's one of those politicians are. Those are the statesmen. And we have very few in far apart. So basically, the life goes on with these kind of politicians coming, going, doing whatever they need to do to be there. But to come to the question again, yes, we will have to balance. And that is where my beginning statement was, right in the beginning, saying that, are we ready with this COVID lockdown and so much reflection on what life would be now? Will the life be the same normal or the different normal we've talked about in the first session? So that was my first question. Will we change our ways of doing things, or even as a consumer, consumerism? Mr. Bhandari said that something like that, if you raise the price, it'll be paid for it. Whatever the resource is, if it's getting depleted, pay more price. I agree. But is this resource indepletable? It always will be there. That's also not there. So how do you put a price to it? How do you put a price to fossil fuel? Is there any price for it? Not really. Because it's depleting, and one day it'll finish. But yes, if we really want to go and balance the development and the politics and everything else, I think there has to be now a stock-taking with all of us, politicians, the corporate world, and the people itself. I'll give you one example without going too much into detail. You know that in Brazil, the kind of deforestation that is happening today is 3 football fields being cut per minute. 27 worldwide, 27 football fields are getting cut per minute. Now, why? And I'm telling you that this, you might feel sitting here, feel very angry that why should it be allowed to happen? And this is a pristine forest, a forest which is absorbing carbon. It is freeing air from carbon from the air. And why is it happening? Now, this, what is happening, will come to your doorstep. Every human being's doorstep, if it is there. Why? Because these forests are getting cut for palm oil. Palm oil, which produces chocolate, it produces pizza, it produces soap, it produces cosmetic, it produces a whole lot of things which we cannot do without today. Can we say that we will not use these things? No. So the question is that, where will we put the balance? how do we do it? And that is for everyone to decide. I mean, if you are going to vote for a politician and get him elected, then you are responsible for that person who is there, who is making these policy decisions. So I think the last thing I'm saying is that every little destruction that goes on comes to your doorstep. And you will have to change your lifestyle to make sure that this doesn't happen further. To a certain extent, I'm not saying that you'll stop living, but I'm saying that this is the time, the COVID, after COVID month, you can decide whether we want to live the way we used to live, even with paying more price. Because I'll give you another example. Sorry for taking time. But Bandhavgarh National Park, there's a limit to how many people can go into the park. Well, that was decided. Now, because there is more pressure for people to go, they decided, okay, you have to pay double the price if you're adding on to a brake vehicle. The vehicle are still going full. There are people still wanting to go more. So the money is not, there's no shortage of money. It's a matter of where you put a stop to these destructive elements, which is going to hurt your nature, hurt your environment, and ultimately hurt you, because it's going to come back to you.
Abhi, can I just enter this point 2-3 minutes?
Yes, sir. Please do.
Yeah. So, you know, I just wanted to, since Tanvi raised this point about R&D in, various, whatever, all the sectors. So, I just, it'll probably be of interest to her. Now, we know that in India, private sector hardly does, any R&D. It's mostly the government. R&D in India is saying right now, the total budgetary allocation of R&D in India, 32% goes into defense research. Basically, total budgetary allocation, 32% of it goes into DRDO. Another 19% goes into space, to the Department of Space. Fair enough. India is, trying to, be a space power. So, and it's not very, space is not, it's not cheap. It's very expensive. Then another 11% is allocated to ICAR, Indian Council for Agriculture Research. In the bottom five are ICMR, which gets just 3.1% of India's total R&D budget. ICMR, which is currently leading the fight against COVID. Ministry of Environment gets 0.5, and Ministry of Renewable Energy gets 0.1% of India's budget.
That is quite shocking. Thanks for sharing that, Mr. Singh. But it's quite shocking, I must say.
But Mr. Singh, just to quickly follow up on that kind of statistics, and this is a question also coming up in the chat box. The population, we know that, ever since we were in school and every time there would be a debate about anything, population is our favorite topic. And yet it's also something that we cannot address. Now, do you think that we can, take out this entire environment debate against this kind of environment versus development frame unless we address population as a challenge specifically? Or would you say that, that remains a constant challenge in our thinking on environment cannot continue to be guided by that one major problem that we continue to face? So in thinking about environment, do we address the major challenge of population directly, or do we say that we flag it and we still do what we can on the environment front?
I would say we can do two things. One is, of course, on population. Secondly, as what Narayan Murthy was saying, that maybe we should have slums and shanties in urban areas to take care of them. I would rather say that it is better, instead of, you do that. I'm not saying that don't do that, but it is better, and I think maybe more from the long-term point of view, it'll be better if you create economic opportunities more in the rural areas and in smaller towns. I mean, why do we have this huge urban jungle? It's because these people, the migrant workers, who don't have jobs in their you know, villages and small towns and, you know, wherever they come from in UP and Bihar, they come to urban centers for jobs. If there were jobs available there, I'm sure, you know, more than half of them would rather remain with their family members and, you know, in the sort of environment that they're comfortable in, than come thousands of miles away, you know, hundreds of kilometers away from their homes, right, and seek jobs in you know, big cities where life is very uncertain. So I, you know, maybe they can go side by side. Mm. I would say that.
Mm. And then, Avni, can I also actually add to that, or rather answer the question? I don't think a lot of us truly grasp the population on Earth and the rate at which it is growing. It's, I think, again, it was Mr. Krishna Kumar who said, we can't comprehend numbers properly. We have, in 200 years, the population has gone from being 1 billion to 7.5 billion people. And it is growing at an exponential rate. It is showing absolutely no sign of stopping. It is difficult to even convince people, like, how do you tell people to stop procreating? It is a very difficult challenge. 2 years ago, in November 2017, 15,000 scientists had published an article called World Scientists Warning to Humanity, Second Notice. They had clearly outlined that this is the biggest threat to humanity right now, because the stress we are placing on the resources is far, far, far greater than the actions that we are taking to curb it. And population right now is an immediate threat. It is one of the biggest problems we are facing compared, I think, equal to climate change. So yeah, that's something people should definitely, please have one child or don't.
Can I jump into this conversation for a while now?
Yes.
So there are a bunch of interesting points which have come up, and I've been taking a few notes. Now, one, of course, the video that Mr. Krishna Kumar Singh showed us, the amount of destruction that man has wrought in 1 second out of 24 hours is truly breathtaking. And it gives us some pause for thought. Now, population, Avni, in fact, there's a positive message I have specifically for you towards the end of what I'm saying at the moment. But population, as people are beginning to recognize now, with growing, the developing society starts to decrease. Japan is facing this. Significant countries in Europe are facing this. Our problem in India and Africa, I guess, at the moment, is that the level of education and development of, you know, in terms of poverty that we have, typically poor societies and uneducated societies have a higher population rate, and educated societies have a negative population rate, which they worry about. And then they start worrying about aging happening in all these European countries and Japan. So there is hope for us. India is already down population replacement rate at an average of 2.1. The southern states are even down to 1.9, which is not even replacement rate, because two people producing 1.9 children. So there is hope in that. If we speed up the process of education and if we speed up development and poverty eradication, we'll get there sooner. And then, of course, it's upon the politicians. As Mr. Krishna Kumar Singh very rightly pointed out, we are responsible for our politicians. We need to engage with our politicians. Another thing that I wanted to speak about was what Kogan spoke about when he mentioned commodification. We're an increasingly monetized society. We see everything through the filter of money. I think this coronavirus has made us for one stop after a few centuries of this since the Industrial Revolution to acknowledge the fact that it's not always only money-driven principles. You know, as soon as industry stopped, our rivers are running clear and blue. Our skies are blue and our leaves are shining. It's a utopian world. We can never have that. We need to produce. We need various things that all of us need. And we're not going to be able to live without them. But it's a question of finding that balance that Mr. Krishna Kumar Singh has mentioned more than once in this conversation. And the startling thing that Kogan said about the budget allocations. So it's all about skewed priorities. And maybe after this COVID, we'll be able to find a balance. Another thing that Mr. K.K. Singh said was that everything comes to our doorstep eventually. And actually, even this virus has come to our doorstep through our tinkering and tampering with the environment. We crowded out the animals. the animals came into very close proximity with us, their viruses have started transmitting. And that the world recognizes now that the rapidity of transmission of animal viruses and pathogens to human beings with the SARS-1, the SARS-2, they're essentially all coming out of other species. These species have had them since ages. But they are in such close proximity to them that they're now mutating out of bat species to us, out of pig species to us, because we've lost that balance between human beings and animals and nature in general. Now, the positive news that I had for Tanvi specifically is that I've been part of a very interesting phenomenon now for the last 6 months, and that is that of collectivism. So Delhi has a new Central Vista redevelopment proposed, the Central Vista being that stretch from Rashtrapati Bhavan to India Gate. And a lot of us woke up to it, suddenly realized that there was something very thoughtless about it in many, many ways, from the heritage perspective, from the environment perspective, from the fiscal perspective, and suddenly came together. Now, all of us individually would have had no voices. But as soon as we've come together, it's been a struggle. It hasn't been easy. And Khogen, actually, it has been very difficult to involve the media, because the media has been one of the most commodified things. Today, it has taken us 6 months. And 6 months where we have gone and woken up statespersons, politicians, thought leaders, one by one, educated them on what's wrong with it, when they've all woken up to join us. And today, when they're joining us, today, when there's something sensational in it, when, you know, prominent politicians speak out across the board, from the left parties to the Congress, that suddenly media is now covering it. But there was a grim silence for many, many months, essentially because media sees everything completely in a monetized fashion. Also, media doesn't see that it has opportunities to create new dialogues. For example, there is a gentleman called Ranjit Lal who writes in the Indian Express. Now, he writes very humorously around animals and the environment. We like to read it. So if somebody, instead of only writing about sports and movies and the economy and politics, devoted time to writing in an interesting, humorous manner about things like environment or even architecture. I mean, as a country, we don't discuss architecture. I go to the UK very often because my brother lives there, and I pick up every third day's newspaper has a topical, maybe witty, maybe humorous, maybe serious conversation on architecture, because we all live in a built environment which is created through architecture. In our country, we don't deal with this. Our newspapers only deal with things which are sensational and sell easily. They can easily create a dialogue, a very interesting dialogue around many, many other aspects of human life, which only get left out because I wouldn't even blame a senior journalist like you at all in it. It's essentially the proprietors, I guess. The easy commodification is movies and sports. Those are the pages that have the highest ad sale value for the ads. So then they increase the amount of news coverage to that. Politics interests all of us, of course, put that in as well. We're a very political nation. So it's a question of skewed priorities. And the skewed priorities are now emerging in our cities. If we have learned anything from COVID, it is that everything is interconnected. Every action of man has a ramification somewhere in the environment and is going to bounce back at us, as Mr. Krishnakumar Singh was pointing out. Now, if you look at just two recent developments and two ongoing developments to do with the large cities that I'm aware of, I'm sure that it is equally true of every other city in India that I may not know about. There were the Bombay mill lands were developed a few years ago. That was a remarkable opportunity for Bombay, which is a choked city. It's a very dense city. And there were hundreds of acres of land where mills used to be and which are now redundant, which were available to the city. Now, instead of pausing to think about what it is that the city needs desperately, which could now come up there, you know, Bombay lacks parks, Bombay lacks schools, Bombay lacks large hospitals of the nature that we see in Delhi. The land plots available, even Leelavati, situated on something minuscule when you compare it to a hospital in Delhi. Now, instead of thinking about those aspects, what did we do? We went and built luxury condominiums on it. The same thing in Kidwai Nagar and Nauruji Nagar in Delhi. There was valuable central land available at a major node like the South Extension All India Medical Crossing node. What did we go and do with it? Instead of building dharamshalas for all those people who come and live on the pavements outside ALES to come and stay in, to instead of building hawker centers, which not only the people who come there for treatment would eat at, but probably you and I would eat at, because we'd get litti chokha from Bihar and we'd get other interesting foods from the rest of the country. What did we go and do? We built these opaque, black, reflective glass box offices, which enough developers are doing. So, you know, this is all a developer-driven model of urban development, which eventually comes back to slap us all in the faces as citizens. The lucky message here is that if we wake up as a collective, as an intelligent collective, and slowly, politely start pointing out the pitfalls and demanding certain things, I'm very glad to say that after 6 months, it does show results.
Right. Right. And Mr. Bhandari, I have very important kind of, you know, towards the ending of the conversation. You know, I mean, Mr. Murthy has actually given us, a hope in this idea of collectivism. And I'm going to, you know, put it at the top and say, you know, this could be like our takeaway from the session, hope in collectivism. But as stands things today, and speaking from a slightly more realistic perspective, if I may, with absolute hope in collectivism, you know, there are two things I want to draw your attention to and seek your responses on. See, one is, you know, for example, even Mr. Damodaran, he was our panelist on the last panel in the first webinar. He's here today. And his question is that, you know, he's saying that more and more people need to stay back in villages. And that's when, you know, we are going to move towards sustainability. I'm just going to pick a hint from there and say that there is this entire rural-urban divide on the one hand, where when we're thinking about sustainability, we have to think about, you know, how to make sure that, you know, we draw balance there. At the same time, there's a balance between that has to be drawn between private initiatives on one hand and the government initiatives on the other. So, for example, a lot of people in the chat box also asked about, you know, should we just look more towards the private players in moving our shift towards, you know, a greener, a cleaner future? Or do we continue to look at the environment from the governmental lens? Now, of course, also having you, I'm sure you're somebody who's also had experiences of working with the government and how fragmented the government machinery is in India. I mean, if we talk about institution mechanisms, both at the national level and the international level, it is fragmented like how? And we do not have a robust institutional mechanisms. So here is my question. Where do we see the epicenter of that balance? There is a rural-urban divide. There is a private versus the government. There is a national versus international. And the beauty of environment as a subject, which also makes it different from other subjects, is, you know, being able to crisscross these different frameworks. That is its beauty. That's also its challenge. So where do we find that epicenter of balance amongst all of this?
So look, it's a handful, but let me try and address each one of these things, right? And I've listened very carefully to the panelists, so, and I think it's fascinating, the thoughts. First of all, you know, let's talk about government versus private, right? This has been a historic debate in India. It comes from, frankly, decades of quasi-socialist approach, or frankly a socialist approach in our own educations, right? So we all have that background. The government feels that private sector is out to make profit. The private sector feels that the government is frankly out to, you know, to delay and to frankly profit themselves, frankly, to be honest. So I think that the reality is environment pierces all those walls. You know, there was an interesting question that Tanvi asked, and I think Mr. Krishogan Kogan gave an example of how much the government spends on research. I will tell you from my experience, and this is not just in India, but in frankly every country, government's resources are very poorly spent when government meddles in industry, research, or all activities of this sort. The government should provide schools, hospitals, care for the needy. Those are good governmental activities. Governmental research labs, if you look at the productivity across the world, it's quite low, right? There is enough research going on in the environment. You don't need the government at all. In fact, environment is one of these things where the technology will come from a lab in Germany or a lab in the US, and the manufacturing will be done in China at a cost that, frankly, neither of those countries can do. Then the panels will be assembled or layered somewhere else. And that's how we run. We've invested $4 billion into this, so we have a pretty good idea of how the supply chain works. Each country adds something to it. Every country is very supportive. In fact, India was the only one of the few governments, along with US, that decided to impose tariffs or duty on renewable equipment, right? So overall, the role of the government is not what it used to be 20 years ago. Today, the role of the corporate sector, role of Apple, frankly, is probably higher than many of the governments that you find. I think there is a rural-urban question as well. I think India is better served using the German model of actually the Mittelstand, which is basically the mid-sized companies out in the north and in the semi-rural environment. Otherwise, you have mass migrations, clever politics that give everything for free. So therefore, frankly, you can't afford it, right? So you can't afford a good response to COVID because instead of spending money on hospitals, which is the primary role of the government, government went and spent money on nonsense that they were not supposed to spend. Right? They meddled in industry, they meddled in pet projects. And here we are, so in Kidwai Nagar, instead of a hospital, they built a government office, right? So it's an organism, it breeds. So, you know, you have to be very realistic about what organizations do. So I think when it comes to all this, the central question, and you see a number of questions coming out, is who's going to pay for this, right? So here's the bad news, guys. India is a current account deficit nation. We borrow 3-4% a year. We can't afford our means. So we are not living in our means. That's okay. I mean, lots of people borrow. US for periods of time has borrowed a lot. Currently, it's borrowing a lot, right? So you have to attract capital, and it's okay to have some borrowing as long as you're using that money for good uses. If you waste it, it's no different than, you know, frankly, your own households. If you run up a big credit card bill and you wasted that money, then it's going to be very difficult for you to pay. So it's good to borrow for education. It's good to borrow for healthcare, for a society. It's good to borrow to make the society productive. But overall, as I look at the Indian fiscal balance, there's no money. COVID will leave us poorer. So that's an unfortunate truth. People don't want to face it, but that's the truth. What does one do after this, right? So no different than when you posed a challenge, and every time the Indian society has faced a challenge, it has come out ahead. So go back into time in 1990s, country ran out of money, they were forced to sell their gold, and then they liberalized, right? This was not a active thinking society. We are a very reactive society because it's a very fragmented society. There's no consensus. Crisis brings about consensus. It forces human beings to face the grim reality of what they are all about and forces people to prioritize. Otherwise, you want everything. You want to have your cake, you want to have the ice cream, you want to eat it too. So this crisis, much like what has happened in Taiwan, forced Taiwanese people, and hopefully for us Indians, forces the society to really look at ourselves and say, what do we want to prioritize? Do we really need that extra X or Y? Do we want to spend our money on a fancy office, as Nanu's example, or do we want to spend our money on a hospital? Do we want a hawker center because it's a more efficient use of our resource? Or do we want to build a fancy mall, right? And I hope this crisis teaches us that, right? I don't know. I'm not smart enough, but it's a collective society. And so society has to figure out where they spend their time. But please do not rely on the government. Government is basically friction cost. It's always been. It's a reallocator of capital. It has existed from the Roman times and the Greek times and has been about the same. Politicians, as Mr. Krishna Kumar said, do come in two shapes and sizes. Every once in a while, you're blessed with a statesman, but there is a long list for every one statesman of hundreds of, let's say, normal politicians, right? So they're just basically parsing you back what you want. So I think for us, in order to pay for the environment that we want, because you have to, right? I mean, nobody's going to magically provide it. We wish that people behaved a certain way, but people don't. They respond to economic incentives, personal incentives, which is frankly everybody trying to do a good job, to bring up their kids, to raise a good family, to progress in life, right? So this is a very deeply entrenched system. You're not going to replace it. Everybody who's tried it, you can look at Russia, Cuba, everybody's failed, including China, right? I mean, it's called the Communist Society, a Communist Party, but it's more capitalist than you can imagine. So I think overall, we need to focus our system on producing the outcomes we desire. In order to focus that system to produce the outcome you desire, you have to put environment ahead. Why? Look, frankly, people spend a lot of money watching IPL. People spend a lot of money, watching movies. And it's okay to consider that cost will be paid, so that India too can actually shut down a lot of its coal plants, breathe the clean air that frankly we all deserve, and understand there is a cost. So next time, you see the poor farmer burning his crops, please don't be sad for it. It's like no different than Union Carbide releasing cyanide. What gave him the right to burn the crop? No different than burning rainforest in Brazil. Nobody gets the right to burn the rainforest. And it's not okay to ignore it. So I think that is where the role of the government comes in. But it is governments, after all, a reflection of society, right? So it's no different than the press. Governments serve you what you want. Occasionally, you get an erratic outcome or a statesman, but for long periods of time, they don't create value. They're just being a reflection of what people want. And so, I think for India specifically to capture its fair share of green energy is running about 20% currently. Hopefully, that number goes in terms of produced energy higher. Simple things, right? There are thousands and thousands of wind farms that are not getting paid. So look, I mean, even before COVID, right? I mean, there were governments in various parts of various states announced that they're not going to honor their contracts. And we as society look at it and we are okay about it because we think it's somebody else's money. Well, guess what? Then the next time the guy is not going to build that wind farm because he understands that government seems to walk away from its contract willy-nilly. What happens then? The next time you need that contract, which you will, the cost of that contract goes up. Nobody tells you that. People don't announce it, never makes it into the news. But every one of these frivolous actions causes the cost of capital for a country like India to go up, which is terrible because we can't afford it. We should be doing everything possible to make laws crystal clear, contracts crystal clear, so that our ability to attract capital is super easy. We have the cheapest capital in the world because we need it. So by these types of interventions, either political or judicial, the cost goes up, and for a fiscally deficit country, that's very, very difficult to do. So we're running the wrong way. We have to run the Singapore way, right? So this was a swampland that decided that they want to progress. What did they do? They have no resource. They have no oil, nothing, right? So they decided to have a very good judicial system, a very efficient government, and a ruthless execution of contracts.
And
where are they today? Fantastic.
I wish some.
That was after India was independence, by the way. Much younger society.
I wish some of what you're saying was actually, seeped into the minds of our judiciary. When we do have NGT, National Green Tribunal, but I don't think that's a perspective that we kind of approach the environmental matters that come forth. But that's a lot of beautiful summing up that you've done for us, and also a very challenging thing to do. If the panelists may allow, if we can take one or two quick questions and allow some of the people to make quick interventions. We have with us Mr. Prabhu Ghate. Sir, I've unmuted you. I think, if you ask your question, all the panelists should be able to hear you, including all the attendees. Can you hear us? Can you ask your question, please?
Yes, I can, but let me get back to you in a moment.
Sure. Yes, Absolutely. So we have another intervention from Mr. Madhav. Sir, can you talk? I unmuted you. Do you think you can ask your question now? Mr. Madhav, do you think you're able to ask your question? I'm sorry, I'm trying to unmute you, but I don't think I'm able to do it for some reason. Do you think, Mr. Madhav, you could type out if you still have a question for all the panelists in the chat box? Any last thoughts from the speakers before we end today's session and we come back to Mr. Prabhu just before doing so? Any last thoughts on the session? Mr. Krishnakumar, I want to just come to you and say if you have any concluding thoughts for all of us.
Well, I'll come back to where I began from. Mm-hmm. I know we've gone in complete circle by now. So what I began with was that in the time of this COVID, we have been locked down for 2 months and more. I'm putting that question to all the panelists and all the people who have logged in today. But do you think that this COVID experience, again, I'm asking because I've asked just a few minutes back, that this will change our way of looking at how we spend and how we live our lives? Is it possible that COVID could be a catalytic agent for this our survival plans to change the way we did business so far, and are we going to do the business the same way once this lockdown is lifted, or we're going to look at it in a way that we will tighten our belt in the sense that okay, if we will not do something which is not environment friendly? Now that is one question to you all. The second thing I wanted to address, some of the things that Tanvi had mentioned earlier, especially where there's not enough incentive for that kind of work to be carried on and done in a passionate way that is required, and it does not pay you well enough, or rather not say pay you well enough, but at least it does not give you enough incentive to keep doing it without much appreciation and any changes that can be talked about by your work. Because everyone, when someone does any work in the society, it seems for a change that is that person has made in the society or larger society. So if you're getting frustrated in the kind of work that is not being appreciated, there's not enough incentive, the only thing I can tell you is that I think you are in a profession where it's not only incentive, but it's a pleasure to be where you are. We all sort of really, at least I am envious of the fact that I cannot be in Bandhavgarh and taking pictures, which I used to do. And today I'm not being able to do that. But I think you have a fantastic field of work. And I can say that every photograph that you take, every picture you take, as everyone knows, is equal to 1,000 words. So all we can keep talking about it, but your one picture should be able to give a message which takes away a couple of 1,000 words. So I think please do not get heartened. I think we all want that one day you make a difference in the world.
Thank you so much for your generous comments. I think we should take this one offline though.
Can I interject here for a minute?
Yes, yes. Last panel comments. We have about 15 minutes.
Sure. Tanvi, to add to what Mr. Krishnakumar Singh just said also, that is also youth to a certain extent, because at that age, you know, one is not heard and taken seriously. But let me tell you from the vantage point of 53, that if you keep on sincerely doing, seriously doing, enjoying what you're doing, there will come a point by middle age when there will be a significant enough recognition of what you've been up to and saying all the while. And then you will find you'll be able to make much more of a difference. There is a space for everybody here. And as Mr. Krishna Kumar Singh said, for the moment, enjoy the fact that you're so lucky that you're sitting in Africa among wildlife while a lot of us are living in dirty cities. Now, coming back to cities, there is a very valid point that Narendranath made, which I saw in the chat. And there are points that people made earlier as well. You see, we've got to give up this romantic notion that villages are ever going to be the place that people are going to want to live in. Narendranath works with people in villages and has been doing so since the 1980s. The poor in areas like Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand. And as he pointed out, people don't want to live in cities. And that's not a reality that's only true to India. It's not that India that, you know, opportunities exist in cities and people come to cities. This is true of as diverse societies as China and the US. The tri-state in US, which is those three cities whose name I forget, but Gautam will remember better, has grown to be one of the largest urban agglomerations. Human beings, because we've divided up our skills very finely, we do very narrow bands of what it takes for the human race now to exist. The natural place now increasingly for a mass of human beings to live is turning out to be the city. The only people who can live in a village are either in a village or on a hilltop or on a beautiful seashore are people who either cannot afford to live in a city at one fag end of the society or people who don't need to live there anymore. They can afford the luxury of living on that quiet seashore. Resources come to them. But for the larger mass of humanity, cities are inescapably the future. Urbanists recognize this, sociologists recognize this. The question is now going to be, how do we make our cities balanced, equitable, sustainable environments for human beings and coexisting? That's it. Thank you.
I quickly want to ask now, so we have two people who raised their hands early on. Mr. Prabhu Bhatte, are you able to speak now? And would you be asking your question or making your point now?
Yes, I just had a question about the urban environment too. It seems to me that since we've all got used to sitting at home, it might be much easier to enforce things like the odd and even number system and a lot of other things like that. Because in a way, you know, this experience has opened our eyes and has given us the beautiful blue skies. Of course, it will entail a lot of hard thinking and long-term planning on improving public transport, the bus system in Delhi. I live in Delhi. Cycle lanes, things like that. But am I being a bit naive, hoping that this experience will make us a little more sensitive to these things?
Open to any of the panelists to respond to this.
Look, I would say that overall, I'm an optimist, right? So I'm an optimist. Humans always come out ahead. You do not want to bet against people. People, they may not get it right the first time, but they do get it right. And I think so. I do believe in the goodness of people. I do believe that people eventually want to do the right thing. There is a moral compass that always points north, right? So I think in that sense, I think sometimes it takes a near-death experience for people to recognize where north is. And sometimes that near-death experience, frankly, reshapes society. So I do believe this crisis will probably teach us that, you know, we need to spend on healthcare, which is the right place for the government and other people. It'll teach us that, you know, the blue skies are possible. It is possible to see the Himalayas from UP and other places. And I think people hopefully will miss that. So because they miss it, they will try for it. And the next time you will see that, you know, frankly, to my very mundane point, right, that somebody is either polluting or the governments are canceling a contract for a green energy project that they had signed up to. I hope you frankly protest. right? And if you don't, right, lots of people ask what they could do. If you take these things lightly and if you sort of say, it's okay, it's not in my backyard, or it's okay, the guy is poor, so he has to do it, or that industry has to dump it in the river because it's a small-scale industry. It cannot afford a big plant. And see, we have to get good with the reality of the ground, or aisa hi hai, or chalta hai. You know, those are the words that have caused us to be where we are. So as going through an experience like COVID, at least for me, I think we will come out ahead. We should come out ahead. And then finally, I would say, if we don't, then shame on us. I mean, I don't know what else we could do, right? In a sense, you go through a near-death experience, you don't learn anything from it, then truly you deserve to live where you live.
And I just want to take a moment to acknowledge that Mr. Prabhu Ghate, is it right? Are you bachelor of 1959, sir?
Yeah, that's right, 49 to 56. I did my entire schooling in Delhi College, from kindergarten to senior Cambridge.
Excellent to have you. Excellent.
Very proud of it.
Thank you.
And just thank you for joining us.
Last question from Mr. Madhav Thabai. Sir, can you ask your question? Mr. Madhav Thabai, are you able to hear us? And you're unmuted now. You'll be able to ask your question.
Hello.
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
You can hear me?
Yes.
No, I'm asking a very basic question to the experts, old aliens. That this COVID thing, is it because of the environment thing, or is it the Chinese have attacked the world? A very, very big
Can I answer that question?
Yes, please, sir.
Yeah, so there is no conclusive evidence on the origin of this disease. Trump, of course, says that it was produced in a lab in the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And then he has, sort of attacked the world. China has attacked the world with it. But I don't think that's true. Most experts have sort of debunked that theory. But there is a general consensus building up that it originated in the bat. Now that COVID is a sort of zoonotic disease. Now, if you see most of our, recent epidemics that we have had in the world, from Ebola to SARS to MERS to Zika, most of the epidemics have been, transmitted from animals to humans. And there is a study by the CDC, which is the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in America, which has said that 3/4 of all diseases in the world are animal and human. There's an animal-human relationship. So given that, I think, the importance of this debate comes in, that if you, plunder environment, biodiversity, so COVID is going to be the result of that. That's because, in these natural habitats of, the forests, these microbes are there. But then these microbes don't come out from those biodiversity areas and pass it on to humans. They circulate within the animal world, and the animal world has its own immune system, which can fight the virus. So more and more evidence is coming out that, about diseases of the, the recent past are animal and humans. But so this is what the general conclusion is about from the experts. Now coming back to, whether we will come out, India or the world will come out more strongly out of this. I think if you look at the history of epidemics in the world, human beings have come out quite strongly after, you know, a massive sort of epidemic outbreak. If you see 18th century, 19th century industrial revolution, huge amount of, you know, cholera and all sorts of diseases all over the world. And, you know, a lot of this infection and transmission happened through human to human, and, you know, and it was because of poor sanitary systems in all of Europe, which was at that time leading the industrial revolution. Since then, we have come a long way. This sewage system, sanitary systems are much better all over the world. Come to, you know, this current century, last century, we had the Spanish flu. Again, I think about, from what I remember, about 2-3 crore people died. But then again, the world came out stronger. And in most countries, we had the sort of public health system came into place. So I personally feel that, you know, I would agree with Gautam saying that we have to be optimistic about it. And I'm quite sure that the human race will come out stronger out of this this crisis. Coming to, what suggestions I have, I can probably just say two sort of suggestions. One is we need a huge amount of, you know, political will to you know, in India, I'm talking about India, in India, to fight this crisis. What Mr. Krishnakumar sir said, you know, about politicians, you know, on environment, on any issue in India, political will is something which is hugely lacking. You know, just take the case of water, you know, conservation. We here talk about, you know, we teach our children, beta, pani waste mat karo. We, you know, government takes out ads in newspapers that when you're shaving, don't keep the tap on because it wastes water. Children in schools are also taught ki, you know, beta, you know, a lot of people in the poor people don't have access to drinking water, so don't waste water. But if you see the figures of water consumption in India, 5% of India's total water consumption is domestic. Another 6% is industrial, which is, you know, all these industries, commercial establishments, offices, what have you. 6%. 89% is agriculture. Now, does the government or our politician have the courage of conviction to tell the farmers that don't waste water? They don't, because it's the farming community, the rural community is a huge vote bank for them. But instead of that, you have a case like Punjab, where about 20 years back, the then Akali Dal government, they made power free for the farmers. So what do all the farmers do, whether they are small farmers or big farmers? They run the tube well 24/7. 365 days of the year, whether they want the water, they require the water or not, with the result that Punjab today, if the water table in Punjab today, if it is not the lowest, it is among the lowest in the country. So political will is required in, you know, to tackle all these issues. And secondly, I would suggest that, you know, if we can have some more, you know, domain experts in decision making. Right now, most of the decision making lies with the bureaucracy and the political class. If we have some, you know, experts, domain experts in, you know, decision making, especially, you know, long-term decisions that have long-term impact, that would be nice.
Yeah. Sir, I think, you've made a very valid point about also the need to bring in expertise, and the need to bring in experts to kind of help us navigate some of the challenges we are facing. We have amongst us Mr. Dheeraj Bora. Professor Dheeraj Bora is a Vice Chancellor at Assam Science and Technology University, and he's also an old alien. Sir, can you hear us? I've also unmuted you. If there are any observations you want to make, please share.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yeah, okay. I'm an old alien, Dheeraj. KK would know me because we were more or less contemporary. And I have since then gone through many, many different areas, worked in many things. But my forte is basically alternate source of energy. Since we were talking of renewable energies, I would like to throw a little light on this fact that renewable source of energies cannot anytime take over the fossil fuel, which will be depleting over the years. So one has to think of some alternate source of energy as well. So in that area, I think we have nuclear fission, which is giving us some about 3% of our energy in India. But there is another cousin of fission is fusion. So in fusion, in fact, there's a big effort going on now. India is one of the full member in an international project called International Thermonuclear Energy Reactor. And this is being built in south of France, Carrarache, and India is contributing 10% into this. And we hopefully, in fact, I was there for about 7 years as a deputy director general, working on many of the areas there. So we plan to bring in 500 megawatts of energy to show the world that fusion works. And then it has to be prototyped with a demo. And by the middle of century, probably it will take over also. It will try to help fission in the whole area of energy, what we are talking of. And if there have been many calculations. And in fact, let me tell you that in solar energy, for example, what you see, what we read in the newspapers are the template values. That means under the best condition of everything, you would generate that power, which never happens. Either cloud comes in or, you know, the energy reflectors are not very properly focused, etc., etc. Therefore, and coming to wind, actually, it will never be able to generate more than 1 terawatt of energy anytime. And what we are talking of in the middle of the century, the world is looking for energy consumption of something like 50 terawatts, which is about, I think, around less than 15 terawatts right now. So this is the energy scenario, what I just wanted to tell you about. I'm very glad to participate in this. I have been listening to the proceedings in the last one, as well as this one, very interesting. We are trying to do, in fact, one of the Ramsar site of India, which is known as Dipper Bheel, it is right in front of my university. And we are trying to actually do some activities with the water there and trying to, as you were talking, we were listening to our panelists on how water is scarce and how we are going to. In fact, I was in Gujarat, and there we in the city called Rajkot, even today, people get, in the summer, people get water, a bucket of water per head every alternate days. So you can imagine the situation already is really, we are probably manipulating the environment in really too bad way. We need to change our habits. And as KK Singhji told, that we need to probably change our habits when we come out of this COVID
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Bora. It's just amazing, you know, to kind of have this opportunity to hear from, you know, all such senior people such as yourself. And it's also very interesting. And I think the most positive note out of this webinar is to see that people are actually willing to sit down for 2 hours on a Saturday evening and talk about environment. So clearly there is hope. But I will let Mr. Bhandari, you know, give us a last word for the evening and probably maybe even respond to what Mr. Bora was saying about, you know, his point about the clean energy. So, you know, so I will let you respond to that because that's your domain area. And with that, you know, we will call it an evening. Yes.
Sure. Look, I mean, it's a good example of human ingenuity, right? So we are faced with a very big problem as with given our current sort of society, we consume far more energy than we produce, and that is sustainable. So I think the solution here will come from a number of sources. Including discoveries, solar panel efficiencies are going up, wind efficiencies, offshore wind are going up. We started the same area that we used to take to generate 1 megawatt has been reduced by a factor of 16. And I think then you have fusion, fission, all these other forms of energy. So it'll be a collective solution. Goes back to my optimism. Humans are remarkable, right? We have very good thinking. We sometimes have confused societies and even more confused governments. But in the end, I think the people prevail, right? And frankly, it's people and time, right? So if you actually think about your time, and I think Tanvi said, look, whether people are able to do this, are they recognized? I think Nanu correctly pointed out that it takes middle age to get recognition. it takes time, human time, which is translated into capital sometimes, but mainly capital or recognition. But it takes a lot of time to do this. A crisis like this is very important for people to reset their bearings, and I hope that is the best thing that comes out of it. There's certainly a human tragedy and that is involved here, which is frankly very unfortunate. It's not a first pandemic, it won't be our last one, right? So I think you have to take that into stride. And I think when you look at it overall, the technology exists. Mr. Bora talked about it. The resources exist. It's not a capital infinite world, but certainly for good projects, the resources exist. India's done a remarkable job. Frankly, 4 years ago or 6 years ago, before Mr. Modi had set out an ambitious program, I have many articles saying that this is crazy, it's a lofty goal, it'll never be met, right? So, and today you're in striking distance. So look at where we have come from, look at where we are going. Much more needs to be done. Unfortunately, there are still impediments. And that impediment is frankly us, just to be blunt, right? Because it generally we have a reasonably benign or socialist way of thinking and sort of moving on, right? People don't want to confront the harsh realities of small cuts. And when you have thousands of cuts, which is called environment, within environment, you have thousands of small cuts, then the human organism and the society bleeds. So I think for me, I think if we emerge out of this with a better understanding and frankly a sharper reaction, it'll be great. You look through every crisis, the emergence of the Green Party in Europe, right? So there are actually blocks, precisely what they're called, Green Party. They have only one agenda, it's the environment. And they, while they never are a majority, they have enough to swing the votes. And so I think this is the type of healthy debate that will eventually, you know, rekindle a society and a civilization that frankly was lost for about 50, 70 years. So in their entire epoch of time, it's not a big amount. It's, you know, we lost our way, I would say, for a few decades, but it's not the end of the world. We, I think, owe it all to ourselves to progress, to push, And even though we always think that we, what's it to do with us? We can't do anything. Frankly, we can. And it starts by voicing, starts by the collectivism that's talked about, starts by contributing one step at a time. And then, you know, next time you see your electricity bill go up or X, don't complain. It's okay. You know, it's okay to get some green power in your bill. It's okay to save the environment. If you drive less, that's okay. If you pay more for an electric car, that's okay too. You know, it's, and frankly, the old system was a subsidy that unfortunately was enjoyed by us, but the cost of that was the rest of the humankind, right? And that was not a fair thing to do. So I think in the end, overall, we're not going to, it's not in, being clean and being poor is not, it's not a bimodal distribution. You can have a good economy as well as, frankly, a very good system and be clean. And I of course look forward to those days when I was young in Delhi. I was in high school. I was in actually middle school. My dad was in the army, and we later went to Indore. But Delhi fogs were white. That's what a fog is. And I think after for decades, I've not seen that white. So I hope you know, very soon fogs will be white and skies will be blue, and we will frankly prevail.
Well, thank you so much for a great panel and for a great discussion. And thank you to all the attendees who actually kind of, you know, constantly engaged. You know, my apologies as a moderator if you thought that, you know, I couldn't take up some of your questions. But unfortunately, we do have limitations of time. But I think we tried to pick up, you know, most of the issues. And I was very happy, Mr. Bhandari, that you actually mentioned Green Party, because my constant question, I was thinking at the back of my mind, and I'm sure, you know, Mr. Krishna Kumar, that could be like a specific question in India. Are we going to see a Green Party anytime in future? You know, so
I think so.
You think so? You think
the time has arrived. I think the time has arrived, yes.
Yeah. So on that note, thanks very much for everybody to tune in and to participate in this set of webinars. You know, a great shout out to Mr. Kripal, you know, who is the president ODA, and Mr. Debashish, who have been instrumental in putting this entire webinar series together. So thank you so much. And next Saturday, you know, hopefully we'll be back with another panel discussion, the broad theme of which will be on policy. So we, in the third webinar, we'll try and zoom in specifically on policy and see what are some of the policy takeaways. And in every webinar, we are trying to kind of, you know, build our conversation on COVID. And it's fantastic that old aliens from across batches and across the globe are able to tune in. And thanks to technology, and hopefully technology is the answer to all our woes. So thank you so much for a great evening. Stay safe and stay warm, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.